In this video, it is time to break free from the limitations of classical physics by introducing the fundamental concepts of special relativity. This theory allows one to describe objects moving at speeds close to the speed of light. The theory of special relativity was published by one of the most famous physicists, Albert Einstein, in 1905. This theory marked the end of the classical era and solved the inconsistencies between Maxwell's equations and Newtonian mechanics. As we know today, the speed of light is built into electromagnetism, and Newtonian mechanics does not apply to these speeds, hence the discrepancy. The theory of relativity, however, turns into the well-known Newtonian mechanics at lower speeds. Thus we see that Newtonian physics is not wrong, so to say, but this theory is an approximation of a greater theory. The essential thing about special relativity is that it made up with absolute time. In special relativity, time is relative. Thus, what happens in space is related to time. This means that all events in the universe can only affect each other if it is possible to send a light signal between the events. This is related to causality and the fact that information cannot travel faster than the speed of light. Thus, if the sun suddenly died, we would only know about it after light from the sun has reached us and told us about it, and this would take around 8 minutes. This also leads to the mind-boggling realization. Everything you see is in the past, it already happened. When you look at the sun, you see what happened 8 minutes ago. When you look at your screen, you see something that happened 1 nanosecond ago. The only thing that is happening in real time is you and what is in your head. When you look out in the world and the universe, you look into the past, and the further away you look, the further you look into the past. Now let's consider what this theory is about in more detail. Einstein's theory of special relativity is based on two postulates. The first postulate states that the law of physics are invariant or the same in all inertial reference frames, or in non-accelerating reference frames. To be in an inertial reference frame, in short, is that you must satisfy Newton's first law that the sum of forces is equal to zero. Or in other words, you are either stationary or moving at a constant velocity. Now this is where things become relative. If you stand at the platform at a train station, you can consider yourself at rest to the train station. You would therefore consider yourself in an inertial reference frame. Now imagine a train comes by with a constant velocity. The people aboard the train also consider themselves at rest, but with respect to the train. So, who is moving? In this case, both are in inertial reference frames, because either you are at rest and the people on the train are moving, or the other way around. In either case, Newton's first law is satisfied. Therefore, the physics on the platform must be the same as the physics on the train. Moving on, one can consider the second postulate, which states that the speed of light in vacuum is the same for all observers, regardless of the motion of the light source or the observer. In other words, the speed of light in vacuum is constant, and from this condition it follows that the speed of light is the maximum possible speed. This is groundbreaking, and it completely breaks with Newtonian mechanics. Consider yourself standing at a platform at a train station, and a train passes by. Let's say the train is driving at 20 km per hour. Aboard the train, a person in the back of the train throws a ball to a person in front of the train. Let's assume that the ball travels at 30 km per hour. The people aboard the train will see the ball traveling at 30 km per hour. But you are standing on the platform and will see the ball traveling at 20 plus 30 equals to 50 km per hour. This is the standard Newtonian relativity, and here we just add velocities. Now imagine that the train is moving really fast at 80% the speed of light, and then the person in the train throw the ball at 30% the speed of light. If we just add up these numbers, we would end up with 110% the speed of light. This is impossible, since we just learned that the speed of light is the maximum speed. How do we resolve this issue? Well, it turns out that in the theory of relativity, you can't just add velocities like in the Newtonian mechanics. Instead, you must use the formula, where v is the velocity, v1 is the velocity of the train, v2 is the velocity of the ball, and c is the speed of light. If we plug in the numbers, we get that the velocity is 88.7% the speed of light, thus it is not faster than the speed of light, and everything works correctly. Since the speed of light is very fast, at around 300 km per second, if you just plug in an everyday speed like 100 km per hour, then the denominator would become 1, and dividing with 1 doesn't do anything. Thus, the result will just be the same as adding velocities as per Newtonian mechanics. Thus, we see from this formula that at low speeds, the effects of relativity are negligible, and the Newtonian mechanics works just fine. Finally, we can consider the case where you add the velocities of two particles traveling at the speed of light. Then the denominator becomes 2, and in the numerator you will have 2 times the speed of light, so in total you will just get the speed of light. Thus one can see that from this equation it is not possible to move faster than the speed of light by adding velocities. Keep in mind that the speed of light in vacuum is the same. This doesn't mean that light travels equally fast, so to say. Light can travel slower through some material, like water. This concept leads to phenomena like Cherenkov radiation, which is the blue light seen in nuclear reactors. Finally, let's consider one of the most well-known equations in the world, which follows from special relativity when combined with other physics. E equals to mc squared, where E is the energy, m is the mass, and c is the speed of light. Many people know this equation, but not all know the meaning and the importance of this equation. Note that this equation describes a system at rest. The equation is different if you're moving. In short, this gives an explicit relation between mass and energy. We see that up to a factor of c squared, mass and energy are the same thing, thus everything that has mass has energy. This later became very important for the understanding of nuclear physics. In short, if you take uranium and split it in a nuclear process, you will get 2 smaller atoms, and the combined weight of these atoms is less than the weight of the whole uranium atom. Thus, the difference in the mass is the energy you obtain from a nuclear reaction. If you pick up a periodic table and do the math, you will quickly see how much energy is in nuclear processes. Einstein's theory of relativity led to much more than what we can cover in this video, and this video just serves as an introduction to some of the most significant impacts. It also killed the idea of the ether, where the light was supposed to travel in, like the way sound waves travel through the air. The fact experiments couldn't detect ether is explained with the fact that light waves are not like sound waves, thus the ether actually just doesn't exist. The solution is given by special relativity, which describes light and fast moving objects in the correct way. If you like the video, please press the like button, feel free to comment and subscribe. If you're looking forward to learn more interesting things about relativity, stay tuned for more.